Hey guys, how are you doing? Welcome back to my channel. This is the Little Bean and Me podcast channel. If you're just stumbling across this is a little podcast about crocheting, knitting, spinning, mostly hand dyeing yarn. I am Kayleen and I'm your host. I'm the principal fiber artist and yarn dyer behind Little Bean Loves Hand Painted Yarn and Little Bean Crochet on Etsy. As always, I will put my information across the bottom of the screen. In the down box down below, if you're on YouTube, if you click, you will see some timestamps for things that I'll be talking about today. Also links to my shop or any other relevant links that I remember to put down in the info box for you. And yeah, that's about it. So I wanted to say a really warm welcome to any new viewers, any new subscribers who have joined in on this little community. Welcome. And I hope you enjoy. So today is coming to you after another long week. Once we thought we were in the clear of illness, of course it strikes again, and this time it was Cece, and she's had a fever for 4 days, so it's been a very interesting, tiring, emotional week for me, so I'm very happy to be here filming this for you. Cece's in the other room right now, playing some games on the TV, and just time to relax, and time to kind of go through everything that I've done this week, and just spend some time with you, which is kind of like my happy place this week. So yeah, welcome. I hope you enjoy. And if you're a returning viewer, definitely welcome back. Say hi in the comments. I'd love to say hi and chat. So anyway, we'll get into everything. I do have some finished objects for you. Actually, this might be a parade of finished objects, to be honest, because I've done a lot of finishing this week because I was done sitting on these whips. You know, every week I tell you, I don't have any finished objects. Well, this week I have like 5 finished objects. Well, 1, 2, 3. Okay, 3 finished objects, but they're pretty big deals. So I have that, I have one whip, I have some dye work and a dye topic to talk to you about today. Today's dye topic is kind of, you know, things that happen in the dye pot that aren't expected. And yeah, so I have some acquisitions, well, one acquisition that was a gift, and that's about it, I think. So let's just jump right in. I will start off with a whip. If you saw I posted on Instagram, I caked up my Woolen Vine Pandora skein, and I showed it, I think, last week. It was supposed to be part of my Schlanket, but it didn't quite work with the theme that I was going for, so I wanted to crochet it up, and I decided to use a star stitch. So I am going to show you what I've been working on. So this is a crochet piece. This is what I have done and frogged and done. So it's a crow knit. I guess it's crow knit. It's crochet and knit. It started out as potentially a cowl. I was gonna make another cowl, but to be honest, I don't need any more cowls. And let's see if I can get a nice shot of the colors for you. It's very bright in here today, so it's a little bright on screen, but I think that's capturing it pretty well. So I started out just crocheting a tube of star stitch. So I did a chainless cast on, or chainless foundation row, which it was a single crochet chainless foundation. I was actually, in the last couple weeks, I was going to put up some tutorials, but if you go over to Adrian's channel, The Freakish Lemon, he did a bunch of crochet tutorials on chainless foundations and changing colors and stuff like that. So it's really awesome. Go check him out. He's awesome. And also, if you're into Star Wars stuff, you'd probably really like his podcast because he always talks about Star Wars and Star Wars fandom stuff and fan fiction. I really enjoy that stuff, so if you like that stuff, then you'll like his podcast. Anyway, so I did a chainless foundation, which is down here, and then I just went into star stitch. And so star stitch is a stitch that is somewhat similar to a puff type stitch, where you're inserting your hook multiple times into the same stitch that you previously were working on. So you insert into the top of the star, the first leg of the star, into the stitch that you worked in, and then into the following 2 stitches, and you're just picking up, and at the end you yarn over, pull through all but one, and then you floop, do kind of a slip at the top. So if you'll see, that's the bottom half of the star, and then the second row for a star stitch, I used half double crochets because those are my favorite, but I did two half double crochets in the point of, in the hole on the top of every star. So it's a very interesting stitch. It's a very nice textured stitch, and I think it shows off a yarn like this really well, something that is delicately speckled. And if you don't want to just do a straight up, you know, basic single, half double, double, treble crochet, then this is a good way to do it. And my Etsy combos. And I'm also a little red. I did just take a shower because this is the first time I've had to shower in, I don't know, 2 days. So I apologize for like the ruddy face and kind of like the wet hair, but you know, I'm taking life as I can. So anyway, this is a really nice textured stitch. It looks a lot fancier. It's a lot simpler, but it looks fancier than it actually is. Yeah, this is picking up the colors very nicely. So you have these delicate pink and black speckles through this entire skein. So anyway, I started out as a cowl, and then I was like, well, maybe I'll make it a hat. So I was gonna crochet a ribbed edging on the cast on chain, but I didn't really like it. So I did a 1x1 rib. So I don't know what's gonna happen with this piece because I'm not always a hat person. Like, see, I look weird in hats, I don't know. So I was thinking about just closing this and making it into a beanie type hat, but I always wear my hair up, so it's almost like waist. I don't know. Or I can just make it into a cowl and keep stitching up, or just end it where it is. And just have it be a cowl. I don't know. If you have an opinion, please leave it in the comments below. It's just, I stitched it all up into a big long hat. It was too long. I didn't like it, so I frogged pretty much half the work I did. This is what's left. This is what I didn't use initially. So I have just yarn everywhere. Hook size for this, I don't remember what I used. I think it was an eye hook. I'm pretty sure it was an eye hook. I don't have it in here. And then I just used my little circulars here. These are US size 6 or 4 millimeter circulars. They're 16 inch circulars for the ribbing. I was doing them on like a 24 inch and it was like just too long. Like, that's the one thing that I find using circular needles is if you're not gonna magic loop, you really need the right size circle for your project. So I was gonna try a 12 inch circular. But this is a 16 inch circular. Nova, Knitter's Pride, Nova Platinum is my local yarn shop sells Knitter's Pride, so I usually end up just grabbing some. And it's also the needles that I used on a present that I'm going to talk about. Ooh, this is lovely lighting. Suddenly the lighting just got really great. The sun came out. So yeah, let's get into finished objects. So I'm gonna talk about some finished objects that I don't have on my person because they've either already gone where they're supposed to, go. So the first finished object I have is, I'm gonna put a picture right here. This is my cozy blanket. I finished it that day when I said, oh, I'm probably gonna finish it this weekend. No, I finished it that day. So I took a few pictures, which hopefully I am posting right here in this space to show you how large it is. It's definitely my wingspan. It's probably a little bit bigger than my wingspan. And if it's at my shoulders, it goes down to my bum. The length of the triangle goes down to my bottom, and it's definitely enough to wrap yourself up in, to get cozy in. It was a wonderful, joyous knit. I enjoyed every minute of knitting on it. It's the first project that I really felt like I had the crochet mindset. So I talk a lot about being a product crocheter, and it was the first knit project that I really felt like product minded about, that I wanted to see the final product, that I was really excited to use the yarn. I mean, I get a little burnt out on the colors that I dye all the time only because I see them all the time, and I almost make that akin to like a singer who writes songs. They get sick of singing their own same songs over and over again, even though you love it or you've only heard it for the first time. So as a dyer, I dye the same things over and over and over and over again, and so I was just like, I was so excited to stitch with my colors, and I was so excited to see them work in the pattern, and I was excited to learn the bind off. I'd never done an I-cord bind off before, so I was so stoked to get it done. So that is finished. Yay! Okay, so next finished object was a gift that I knit out of the scraps of my cozy Schlanket, and appropriately, here it is. It is a gift that I sent over. I sent some yarn over to Mina at the Knitting Expat podcast, and she, if you did not know, has just recently had a little baby girl. If you're on YouTube and you want to go check out her channel, definitely go leave her some words of congratulations. She's also on Instagram as Knitting Expat. She's been posting these adorable little pictures of her daughter. It's just so heartwarming and wonderful to hear that everything has gone well and everybody's healthy. So anyway, I was sending her yarn, and I couldn't not send her something for the baby, because I love doing baby gifts and I love giving that love. I love stitching stuff with love and giving gifts, and I love giving baby gifts because to me there's no more special time in anyone's life, whether you're adopting or you are pregnant or you have a surrogate, you're welcoming a child into your life. It's such a beautiful time, and it's a time that should be full of love and happiness. And so I always like to stitch something that's kind of infused with that. Like, I think about the person, and I think about, you know, the love and the warmth and the happiness and the healthy time that you're supposed to be having with your new baby or your new child. So I had to send her something, and I couldn't think of anything more appropriate than stitching with the leftovers of my cozy Schlanket, because that was one of the most joyous and fun stitches I've ever done. And the yarn, it's Amor Tension, which is a love potion, and it's all the yarn's about love. So it was kind of, it was like destined to be. Like, I had those leftovers, and it was just enough to make a baby hat. It's a little bit bigger. It's probably maybe a 12 month size, if I'm remembering in my brain correctly how large it is. But I just had to. So I just did, I had the most left over of my putty colorway, because that was the last edging I did on the shawl. So I started out in that kind of grayish color, and then I worked my way up and just did some random color work. I just, you know, carried stitches over, did some in the Amor Tension, then I worked in some Dobby, and then some Amor Tension, and then some gray, and then I finished off in the gray. And so I'll put a little close up here of the hat, so you can just see the stitch work that I did. It's nothing crazy. It really is just basic Fair Isle techniques, but because it's a variegated yarn and all the yarns seem very nicely and closely related, it came out so beautifully. It kind of melded together in one piece. So Mina, if you're watching this, I hope you enjoy, and congratulations again. Okay, my battery's gonna die, so guess what? I get to charge my phone, my camera, in the middle of the podcast. So I will see you guys in 1 second for you, but probably maybe an hour for me. So I'll see you soon. Okay, so we're back. It's been a little while for me. Hopefully I have enough juice in this battery that I can finish the podcast. I apologize for any change in lighting or change in position. I had to take you down to charge you. So we were talking about finished objects. So I do have one finished object that I can physically show you here on the podcast. So let me grab it. Okay, so the finished object that I have is, dun, 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 I have socks. Guys, I finished my socks. They're finally done. Hallelujah. I'm so happy that these are finished. So these are the gradient socks I've been working on. Of course, I don't have any sock blockers because I'm not traditionally a sock knitter. So I don't have any, so I'll have to do some creative holding. But these are my socks. These I knit on my own hand-dyed yarn. These were a gradient mini skein set that I conjured up. And I used 60 stitches on size 1 Addi Turbo Rockets, magic loop style, 2 at a time, cuff down. That's all the details, I suppose. I did a fish lips kiss heel, which came out very nice. And then I just did a standard toe decrease. I used the pattern that's listed in the Smooth Operator sock pattern. I can't remember if that's a free pattern or not, but it creates a little bit of a rounded toe, which I prefer because my foot is a little rounded. I don't have, like, my toes kind of go in line. I don't have like that weird big middle toe or big long big toe. Like, they all kind of just go in this roundy shape. So these are my socks and I'm so excited. I did want to talk about a couple of things with them, things that I liked and things that I didn't. I really love two at a time. I am a notorious one sock, one mitten, one item person. So if I have to do more than one to get my finished object, I need to do them at the same time. Look at that gradient. Bio boy. Looks beautiful. Oh, it came out so great. So I love doing them two at a time. The cuff down part was just fine. I didn't have any problems. You can see I was having a little laddering from my magic loop. That's where my needles joined. But I don't care. You're not going to see it. It's going to be stretched out on my leg anyway. The stitches, because they were made in a gradient, they're a little bit wonky. If I block these out or wash them, the texture will smooth out on them. In terms of changing yarn colors, I didn't really have any problems doing that. I thought I might because I'd never really done it on a sock before, and I was also really worried about the holes in the corners of my heels, but I found those easy to cinch closed and kind of get squared away. Am I really blurry or is it just me? Is that better? Sorry if I was blurry that whole time. So I was worried about it, but I didn't have a problem. And then when I got to the toes, I realized that my gradients were a little heavier on the dark side. So you can see it starts to get a little bit lighter toward the end of the foot, but I wasn't going to be able to, you know, go like this, like have this much of the gradient in there. So what I decided to do, instead of doing the green, which I still have, I had enough to do the toes with the green too, but I wanted to have more of the gradient in there. So I decided to do the toes from the opposite end. So these were, if you missed what these were made out of before, I'll put a picture here. These were a gradient set that I did. It was 4 mini skeins and a contrasting skein for heels, toes, and cuffs. And so you had, you know, these were basic, an ombre dye of a single color. So this was just a purple. I did switch skeins in the middle here somewhere. But it went from ecru natural wool color for a short period and then right into this ombre gradient down into the deep, most saturated part of the purple, and then fading back out. So you can see here the fade does start to fade back out again, but I knew that I wasn't going to have enough. My feet aren't that big, so I mean they're big, but they're not that big that I was going to get this much out, because I knew the gradient was heavier on the darker side. So I really like that. Things that I struggled with my toe decreases. So you can see here, the stitching is not as even. It has a bit of a gap here. So you can see where I have the knit two togethers next to each other. So at the ends of each row, you're doing a knit two together. So on magic loop, it's at the first two stitches and the last two stitches decreasing. I almost wish I did a slip slip knit. So I wish I did the knit two together and then a slip slip knit at the other end, and that's in kind of hindsight, just to make it not have this ridge down the side of the toe. If you can see it, there's a small ridge here, and it doesn't bother me on my feet. I wish I'd gone 3 more rows, but I didn't want to make these too long, because I know if I wash them or block them out, they're going to relax a bit because it's superwash merino, so I didn't want them to be too baggy. I'm also not sure if I'm ever going to wear these. Because I don't have any sample. I guess I can just knit some samples on my sock machine, but I don't know. I almost just want to keep these because they're my first knitted sock. But I'll show you. I'm not going to show you my bare foot, but I will show you what it looks like on my foot. Dun, 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 dun. We have sock. Oh. So there it is. It fits really well. Hey, sock. Anybody who's weirded out by feet, I'm sorry. Hi, I have a visitor. Say hi.
Hey, I just
picked. You're what? Here, come tell them.
Here.
What do you have to say?
I just said I'm sick.
You just said you're sick?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Do you need some medicine?
Yeah.
Yeah? All right, I'll get you some medicine. We're gonna take a medicine break. We'll be right back. Okay, so I'm back. I am Sam's visitor, so sorry about that. But yeah, they fit really well. I'm very pleased with the final product. I'm going to probably just soak these and, I don't know, dry them in the dryer because that's how I would normally dry my socks, but I don't know, I haven't decided yet. I'll probably just end up getting some sock blockers, soak them, and then block them on a blocker and see how that goes, just for my own edification. But normally I would probably just wash these in the washing machine on gentle and have that be it. So I like this how it looks too when it's all folded up. It's like you have like the green and then you have like the gradient part. I don't know, I'm weird. So anyway, that's my socks. I'm super excited. I guess I could show you how much I have left. Focus, there we go. So I had some on the other end. So when I started at the light end and went dark, and I have some dark that I've used as scrap and sent as a sample to someone. But this is what I have left of the gradient mini. So I have a pretty significant chunk of yarn left. So I'm not sure what I'll do with this. I might just wind it up into mini skeins and, you know, make a little something in a blanket or whatever. So that's it for that. So, in terms of other things, we can talk about acquisitions. I only have one acquisition, and I have an older acquisition that I wasn't able to show you before, but now I can show you. So I have two things. So one, my husband got for me, which I'm very excited about, and you may have seen her sitting on the desk, but this is Eleven from Stranger Things. It's one of my favorite shows, and she's holding some Eggos. You can see the reflection of the window. Sorry, guys. She's holding her Eggos, and she's in her navy coat with that kind of pinkish dress and socks and all that stuff. So my husband got this for me to put on my little desk here, so when I work I have a little bobblehead. I'm very excited about that. And the other thing that I wasn't able to show you before, because this got kind of lost in the shuffle. If you remember a few weeks ago, if you've been here for a little while, you know that I've redone this room. So this room used to be, it still is our guest room. There's a bed like right here, but it used to be not really conducive to my business and to podcasting and everything. And so I bought new furniture after the new year, you know, along with some other tools that you can see behind me. And this came to me for Christmas time, but ended up getting lost in the shuffle. So I've mentioned her before, but this is Cheryl by Love Knots by Cheryl. She's a crochet artist, crochet designer, and she's on Instagram. And what she does is she takes hand-dyed yarns from her favorite indie dyers, and she makes sock cozies. And now I think she's making business card cozies. But she sent me a sock cozy made from my own hand-dyed yarn, a crocheted cozy. So this is Whomping Willow. You can see it pulls up really nicely. It's great fall colors. This is one of my favorite colors that I dye. But you can put little stitch markers in here or other little notions. If you have like a small needle gauge, it'll fit in there. I wouldn't put needles, like embroidery needles, unless you have them in a separate little baggie. But this is such a cute little thing to put in your knitting bag. So she included that with a progress keeper. And the other things that she makes are, aside from the business card holders, are little bracelets, crocheted bracelets made out of hand-dyed yarn. So this is Whomping Willow in a little bracelet. Isn't that so cute? So she has her buttons that have her business logo information on it. So adorable. And the other thing she included in my package were some chocolate, which promptly got eaten, and then some buttons. And I think she gave me this lotion, unless I just threw it in there, but she gave me some lotion and some buttons. So this one says, "Knitting is my jam." I This one is a butterfly. This one is her business logo. So Love Knots by Cheryl. And then this one is my favorite one. This is quality handmade bleepity bleeps. Poopmojis. So I thought this was a very sweet and thoughtful gift. She sent to me out of appreciation for my hand dyed yarn, and to that, Cheryl, I say thank you so much again, and I'm happy that I could finally show it because I found it in all of this crazy mess from transitioning my room. I'm happy. Okay, so the other week we talked a little bit about a dye topic, talking about like unintentional things that happen in the dye pot, and I wanted to share another experience that I had with you this past week. I had a custom request for the Lost Diadem. I don't know if you could hear Cece sneezing in the back. Poor thing. So the Lost Diadem is a gray tonal with blue speckling, and I don't know why, I don't know how, because I wasn't using this color anytime recently, but on all of the skeins that I dyed last week, I had to dye twice and then a third time, which actually was successful, and I sent to the customer, or I'm sending to the customer today, on all of these skeins is contamination, pink contamination. Now, I clean my pans regularly. I clean my pans every time I have a new dye batch. So if I'm dyeing through the day and I'm doing all the same colors, I'm not gonna wash my pans in between colors because there's no point to do that, especially if your dyes are exhausting from the pan and you know you're using all the same palette, unless you notice buildup in your pans. But for me, this was dyed on a day where I was dyeing several different colors, but I wasn't using this particular color in my dye work, and I didn't know where it was coming from, and I was worried that my dye pot, like the actual pan, canister of dye had been contaminated. Here it is. So I found it. So every skein that I dye, I inspect before it goes out because of things like this. So this happened. It's more pronounced on some of these other skeins. And here's more. And then on this one, it's a very tiny, tiny speckle, but almost not noticeable. Anyway, I can't find it right now on this skein, but they are... So these are contaminated on all four of these skeins. Now, I only had 5 skeins left of this base before I had to reorder, and I was planning to reorder this past Monday, but she had ordered from me, and I had to order more because I had to re-dye this again. And I messaged her right away and I said, listen, I'm having some trouble. And I sent her a picture and I said, these are contaminated. So she's like, I'll just wait until you get your yarn. Don't worry about it. Don't stress. In the meantime, Cece gets what we think is the flu and all these crazy things. But I was able to re-dye and I cleaned out my pan. So this happened because of some dye powder that was sitting on the edge of the pan or somewhere I couldn't see or somewhere that I missed when I cleaned my pans, and it went right on the skein. And I never, if I didn't inspect, especially some of the ones that are very tiny spots, if I didn't inspect before they went out, they would have went out to the customer, then I would have had an issue on my hands because this shouldn't be there. So what's the solution? Obviously these skeins aren't gonna go to waste. These skeins are gonna get re-dyed. Perhaps I will add the color that is contaminating the skein onto the skeins. There it is, it's just a pink color. So I'll just over-dye, like I'll just dye it again, soak them again, speckle them with different colors, and layer them up and see how well I can blend this into the final product, and then I'll have 4 one-of-a-kind skeins going into the shop that are, you know, not exactly what I intended, but something that ended up coming out. Anyway, so those things happen as well. Just a little look into the dye universe. Not every dye session, no matter how simple, this is probably one of the most simple colorways that I do. And because it's only one color of speckle and the color, the base color, I don't have to do like several layers or, you know, do these crazy mixing techniques or like tonal techniques in the pot. Like it literally is a gray tonal with these blue speckles, and it's like it ended up being the most complicated thing. And also considering that last week I dyed 12 skeins of Wig and Tree, which is my most complicated colorway in terms of dye procedures, and those all came out just fine, but somehow these skeins that are like two colors only, or well, the gray isn't just gray out of the pot, it's, you know, it's a custom blend, but in terms of like procedure, I just had to put it in the pan, let the gray and then speckle, and then that was it. And four skeins later, it was a big mess. So those things happen. So let's see, you can see behind me, I have to re-skein that. My dear and wonderful subscriber who is waiting for this skein, it will be out to you, I swear I'm gonna get this skeined up. It's literally just sitting on the Swift waiting for me to be skeining it. So I did have one question in my Ask Me Anything thread this week from Bree. She asked me any tips for getting started on hand dyeing yarns. Her husband, her boyfriend, gave her a gift of a Jacquard dye kit so that she could dye some yarn because she wants to learn how to dye. And so my best advice to you would be to watch YouTube. That's how I knew dye things, but I just watched a ton of videos just to see all different types of techniques, any people who were showing different types of things, like how to do self-striping yarn, or how to do gradients, or how to dye with Kool-Aid, or, you know, color match, learning about color theory. So my first step for you would be to read about color theory. If you don't already have an art background, it's really helpful for you to understand how colors play together, what colors mesh well together, what colors don't, different techniques that will suit different color combinations. And then to watch how people do it. It's really, dyeing yarn is simple. It's acid, heat, and the acid dyes, acid reactive dyes, and the yarn. So that's all you have to put together. There are nuances with blending colors, how to match colors, the different types of techniques, so kettle dyeing versus low immersion dyeing versus steam setting yarn and hand painting yarn. There are a bunch of different ways you can go about it, and some ways lend better to different color combinations than others. You know, if you're doing, say, purple and green, it's really difficult to do pinks and purples and greens together on a variegated skein because when they blend together too much, you get brown, the yucky poo-poo brown. Hi.
I need a mom to turn that video off when that frozen comes off.
You need what?
I need help with that TV.
You need help with the TV?
Thank you.
Okay. TV is all set. So yeah, so read about color theory and just dive in and do it and have fun doing it. You know, it's not, you know, yarn dyeing is not for everybody, just like painting or drawing or any other form of art or creative expression. It's not for everyone. It's fun, and it certainly is a lot of fun to dye for yourself. It's certainly fun to dye for other people, or if you're thinking of making a gift for someone else, you know, to put together a perfect color that you think would suit them. but yeah, just have fun with it. Just take your yarn, put it in the pot, and just go at it. Just make sure you have enough acid, whether you use citric acid or vinegar, that you have, you know, just enough dye in the pot to color your yarn, not use too much. Have enough heat to set your dye, and then make sure you rinse and care for your yarn well afterwards. And that's it, and then you wait for it to dry and it's all set to go. So I hope you have fun dyeing, and yeah, I hope I answered your question well enough. So. I think that's all I had for you in terms of dye work talk, or, you know, works in progress, finished objects. So now I'm going to go into some shop update information and also some daily chatter with my little guest here. Hi.
I help you with how do I do the crab game.
You're trying to do the crab game?
Let's help.
You need help?
Yes.
With what?
With that crab game, Mommy.
You need help with the crab game?
Yeah.
Okay, so, sorry for the interruption again. Interruptions. So, I want to show you some things that are in the shop right now. Cece's upset at the crab game, so you'll hear her protesting. So, I have some skeins, striping. I have some sock blanks that are in the shop right now. I just listed them while I was waiting for the battery to charge, so I wanted to show these to you guys. Kay, the crazy sock lady, is going to be having a sock blank along starting on April 1st. So if you're interested in participating in that and you're interested in sock blanks, then you should come on over to the shop, and I will be having more of these continuing to be listed over the next month or so, dyeing a lot of them so that folks have them for the knit along. So this one is called Puking Pastilles. And it is a beautiful, plummy, pukey, plummy and pukey toned sock blank. So it is a single knit. This is a single knit blank. I dyed two of them at the same time. They're both one of a kind. They have the same general feeling. They're not identical, but they have green on either end and the purpley pink in the middle, and will come out lovely and speckled, and you can get somewhat matching socks from these since the color patterning is relatively regular. You have the green on the ends of the blank and the purple in the middle. So that's Puking Pastilles. Then we have this, which is Spectre Specs. So this is a really vibrant fluorescent pink with this blue-green tone kind of spread throughout. So you get this cool looking, kind of a cool toned electric pink with blue. And this is also single knit, but it reminded me of Luna's Spectre Specs, which is why I called it Spectre Specs. And it's also violently bright. So I have two of these. Two of these available. Single knit sock blanks. Then I have this one, which I called Pensive, which is, or the Pensive, Pensive. It is kind of a watery blue tones, kind of a blue green and aqua type colors. It's hard to see how well the saturation is showing up on camera because my viewfinder tends to look a lot more blown out, but when I edit it, it looks a little more saturated, but these lighter spots here are actually teal. They're not white or aqua. They're kind of an aqua color. So yeah, this is Pensive. And there's one of these available. This is also single knit. And then I have some double knit sock blanks because I had a lot of folks asking if I would dye up some double knit sock blanks. You can get matching socks at the same time. So I did. This is Winter at the Shack. So the Shrieking Shack has some kind of icy blues, grays, and black speckling. It's a little more of a minimalist type color, but still very lovely. Will come out speckled with different variations in tone. So these are double knit. This is a double knit blank. This one is the Black Lake, so it's not exact to previous Black Lake interpretations, but has a similar palette, which is a nice deep and dark blues, greens, and blacks. So even colors that I am attempting to replicate or repeat, they're never going to be exact on a sock blank because of the way that I dye it. So I'm just attempting to create the same type of feel as previous dyes, not the exact same colors, to be exact. Okay, so that's the Black Lake. And then this one I'm calling Forest of Dean. This one is nice earthy tones, browns, yellows, greens. Very earthy, crunchy feeling, quite lovely. also double knit. So you'll see at the ends here, the strands are doubled. So when you pull off of one end of your sock blank, you're going to get two strands at the same time so that you can cast on two at a time socks. So yeah. Forest of Dean. This one is Hagrid's Hut. So this is a real ruddy brown with black speckles. And again, I'm slowly pulling off of this blank, so I'll have to wrap up those ends and make sure they're secure before I pack them and wrap them to ship. But yeah, a ruddy brown with black speckles. This is Hagrid's Hut. Hagrid's Hut. If I can speak today. It's just the nature of dyeing the sock blanks. I like dyeing them a lot. They take a long time to dye because of the technique I use. I have to use a low immersion dye to make sure I get the right saturation. And because I'm not hand painting them in traditional terms, I'm hand painting on the blanks, but I'm not stenciling or like painting and then steaming. I'm actually doing a very low water immersion technique with these, and it takes a long time to do. So this one is one that got a little messed up, so I have to fix it before it goes out. But this one I called Horntail. So it's a very fiery deep red with black, deep black, red black speckles. Fiery colors, oranges, reds, yellows. Definitely an awesome looking color. So that is Horntail. So very vibrant, saturated. I know reds scare a lot of people because they tend to bleed, and it's true, they do tend to bleed. But I wash my yarn very, very carefully so that we minimize any extra bleeding. So when you're washing bold colors like that, reds, turquoises, dark blacks, you always want to wash in cooler water. You don't want to wash in hot water, you don't want to wash in water that's too warm, and you don't want to put too much soap in, because what will happen is the heat and the soap will start to break the bond that the dye has with the fiber and create more bleeding. So when I wash the yarn, you see how vibrantly saturated it is. There's no bleeding in my sink when the yarn leaves my house. So that's a question I get a lot too from people, is what do you do if your yarn bleeds? And there are a few things that you can do. One is to talk to the dyer before you kind of run off the deep end and freak out. sometimes dyes don't get set well if you don't wait long enough. Sometimes dyers use too much dye, and when they wash out, they don't wash all of the excess dye out. If you have a skein that continues to bleed and bleed and bleed and bleed and bleed, chances are the bonds for the dye have been broken somehow. Either when you washed it, it was washed in too warm of water, or the dyer didn't appropriately use enough acid or enough heat or enough time to properly set. So a blank like that, when I washed it initially, had some bleeding from excess dye, but then at the end of the wash, the soak and wash and rinse, soak and wash and rinse, it came out clear. So there was no excess dye coming off the fiber. I wash all my yarns with Euclan, which is a gentle wool wash. It does have lanolin, which helps to recondition the fibers after being dyed so that they stay nice and soft. Mm-hmm. And I use cool water. So normally cool to cold water. If it's ever warm, it's usually just tepid, just room temperature water if it's been sitting there for a little while, but usually it's cold water. So, but yeah, that's a common question that I get. So that's all I have for you guys today. I don't have too much else in terms of, you know, yarn or finished objects or works in progress, but I will talk a little bit about what's been happening with us this past week. As you heard me mention a bit in the podcast, and you saw my little daughter interrupting, she has been sick. So it's been kind of the saga of our lives for the last 2 months, that we've all been sick, just one after the next after the next after the next. And it all started with the norovirus, and it was like on Christmas Day, and it was just, I don't even have a word for how frustrating it was to have that happen, because then other people who had come to our house also got sick a couple of days later because we were carrying it and we didn't know. So it started then, And then from that point until now, each of us has been sick in turn with no more than a week break between, like, if all of us are healthy, it's been for no longer than a week. It's been maybe 5 days that we were healthy. Like last week, we were pretty much all healthy and feeling pretty good aside from like a sniffle or a sneeze or whatever. Nothing major. And then Monday rolls around and Cece gets a fever. And Tuesday she wakes up with a fever. And Wednesday she wakes up with a fever. And Thursday she wakes up with a fever. And now it's Friday and she's still having a fever. So it's just a bit frustrating and a bit disheartening. It just makes me feel like we will never get a break. This will never end. I know it will end. I'm not going to catastrophize. It is just part of life. It's part of the winter. It's part of having small kids, and especially Cece's in preschool. So I've come to expect it, but I just really want a break from all of this illness. And it just throws everything else in the house off. You know, we all have a set routine. I have a set routine with the kids, especially running my own business. I always like to keep our schedule as much the same as we possibly can. Fortunately, this week Cece was already off from school for February vacation, so she didn't miss school because she was sick. But it always throws a kink, like a little wrench, into what we're trying to do as a family. We have a birthday party we can't go to tomorrow because she's been so sick. One of her best kid friends is turning 3, and we can't go celebrate at her favorite place because she has a fever today, and we're not gonna go spread the love, so to speak, with other 3-year-olds, considering this could possibly be the flu, so, or a version of the flu, one of those strains of flu. She has been vaccinated for the flu before anyone says, like, we all get vaccinated for the flu, and she has been, but you know, if it's a different strain than what she was vaccinated for, then it's not going to be effective. So that's what we're thinking happened. So she's just been fevery and achy and grumpy, and she's had fever spikes that have made her so tired. And, you know, you just hurt in your heart thinking, like, there's nothing that you can do except try and get her to eat or drink and get her to rest. And give her medicine so her fever goes down. I mean, you guys saw the interruption earlier where I was like, oh, do you want medicine? And she was feeling yucky enough to want to take the medicine. Anyway, so that's been what's going on with us. Not a lot of fun things happening around here. Mostly just managing sick kids and trying not to spread the germs to anyone else. We were able to go for a walk yesterday, which was nice. It's been very nice here. Kind of like, I don't know, April to May weather almost, you know, 50s to 60s. Yesterday was 65. Today I don't even know how warm it is because we haven't been out of the house yet, and it's probably close to 3 o'clock right now. So it's just been very nice. So trying to get them fresh air and opening the windows and just kind of trying to flush whatever this illness is that's been coming back over and over again out of our house, because I don't want to get sick again, and I don't want Tucker to get sick again, and I don't want Cece to be sick again, or Tyler, because it's gonna be springtime soon, and I just want it to be nice weather and nice healthy times and just back to our normal routine. Like, that's all I want, just please, some normalcy. So any positive thoughts, juju vibes out in the universe are greatly appreciated. So if you could just send those our way, I would really love it. But yeah, that's really all I have for you today. I hope you guys enjoy. If you're having beautiful weather like we are, I hope you're able to get outside and enjoy it with your family, by yourself, with your pets. Just enjoy it. The sun is shining, and it's walkable weather in February, so we're gonna try and take advantage of it, I think, this afternoon. Anyway, I hope you have a wonderful weekend, and I will see you guys in my next video. Bye!